and welcome to Word Magazine. This is Jeff Riddle, pastor of Christ Reformed Baptist Church in Louisa, Virginia. In this Word Magazine number 185, I'm going to be doing something I haven't done in a while, and that is I'm going to be offering some text notes and text commentary on a particular passage with respect to the original Greek text. And we're going to be looking at Matthew chapter 1, verses 7 and 8. And the question is going to be, should it read Asa or Asaph? Again, it's been a while since I've done a text note like this. I will put on my blog, jeffriddle.net, I will put some notes so that you can maybe look a little more closely at some of the things I'm going to share, if you'd like to do that. This Word Magazine is going to be like some of the ones that I've done recently, in that it's being recorded on video, and this will be on the Word Magazine channel on YouTube. And of course, it's going to be recorded by audio, and it'll be on sermonaudio.com and also on iTunes if you search for Christ Reformed Baptist Church. So what is the issue with Matthew chapter 1, verses 7 and 8? I ran across this issue just last Sunday. I was preaching through Matthew 1, verses 1 through 17, the genealogy with which the Gospel of Matthew begins. I'm starting a new sermon series through Matthew, and God willing, I'm going to preach through the entire book. It's probably going to take a couple of years. I did a series through Luke, did 100 sermons, took over 2 years, did a series through John, did over 90 sermons, took almost 2 years. And I imagine Matthew with 28 chapters is going to be at least that long or even longer. But we'll see how it goes. At any rate, the genealogy with which the Gospel of Matthew begins is fascinating. Verse 1, I spent a lot of time talking about it as a title, not only for the genealogy, but in some ways for the entire book in its presentation of Jesus as it begins in Matthew 1:1. The book of the generation of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. And then it begins the family tree of the Lord Jesus with respect to the flesh, beginning with Abraham and goes all the way to Joseph. It's often described as providing the legal line of the origins, humanly speaking, of Jesus. Whereas Luke's genealogy in Luke 3 provides the genealogy of Jesus traced back to Adam. And ends, as many traditional interpreters took it, with Mary. And so it provides the natural line through Mary. She's a Davidite. And then with Matthew's account, which gives a lot of focus to Joseph, particularly in the first two chapters, the line is through David to Joseph. Joseph is a Davidite. So both genealogies stress that the Lord Jesus comes from the seed of Abraham and also from the house of Judah, and that he is a Davidite, a descendant of David. There are lots of interesting things about the genealogy, and I'll just refer you to the sermon that I just preached. You can find it on sermonaudio.com. But with respect to text, as you look over this section, you'll find that a note will be given on the text of Matthew 1, verses 7 and 8, with respect to the name of one of the kings in the line of Jesus. And so the issue is in Matthew 1, verses 7 and 8, what should the reading be? If you have the traditional text, the Greek text, the Textus Receptus, the received text, it will read Asa. That's Alpha, Sigma, Alpha, the name for one of the great kings of the Old Testament. His reign is described in the book of 1 Kings. And then if you have a modern critical text, however, it will read not Asa, but Asaph. That's Alpha, Sigma, Alpha, Phi. And so it's that final letter that's there on the name that is significant. And so this is a variant that relates in on one hand to just one word, but even more so just to one letter in one word. Should it read Asa or Asaph? So if you have the Authorized Version, the King James Version of Matthew 1, verses 7 and 8, it reads, "And Solomon begat Rehoboam," that's the rendering there of Rehoboam, "and Rehoboam begat Abijah," and in the Old Testament, this is the king Abijah, and so, or Abijam, and then after Abijah or Abijam, it's Abijah begat Asa. And then if you go on to verse 8, it says, "And Asa begat Josaphat," and that would be in the Old Testament, it would be Jehoshaphat. So anyways, but the key thing here in the Greek text is that in the Authorized Version and English translation based on the traditional text, it reflects the TR reading for the name Asa, Alpha, Sigma, Alpha. However, if you have a modern critical text, if you have the Nestle-Aland 28th edition, or the UBS 5th edition, or if you even have the Tyndall House Greek New Testament, or if by chance you had a copy of the 1881 Westcott and Hort Greek New Testament, you would find that it would read Asaph, Alpha, Sigma, Alpha, Phi. And so the question is, what is the proper reading here? Again, this is a matter of one word, even one letter. But those of us who are traditionalists, we tend to think that these things are important. The major things about the New Testament are not merely the big texts, whether that's the ending of Mark or the woman taken in adultery, but there are textual variants of significance throughout the entirety of the New Testament. And we often cite Christ's own words in Matthew 5:18 in the Sermon on the Mount, where he said, "For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled." And we see that as speaking to the doctrine of preservation, that God will preserve his word, every jot, every tittle. With the case of one letter, one phi, that would be certainly on the level of certainly a dash of the pen. Barely lifting the pen from the page to write one letter. So should it read Asa, traditional text, or Asaph? So we'll begin by looking at the external evidence. Typically, when there's a textual variant, the first thing that people want to do is look at the extant manuscript evidence. And for this, I'm reliant on the critical apparatus in the Nestle-Aland 28th edition. So if you were to take the critical text, its most recent handbook edition, the Nestle-Aland 28th edition, and you were to look at the variant as it's described in the apparatus, you would find the following. You would find that the traditional reading, Asa, is found in a number of manuscripts. It lists some of the more important ones. It's found in Unsealed K, it's found in L, it's found in W, that's important, that's Codex Washingtoniensis, which is typically dated to the 5th century, maybe even to the 4th century, so it's a very early unsealed manuscript. You've heard me talk about W or Codex Washingtoniensis with respect to the traditional ending of Mark, because it contains in its ending of Mark a variant that's known as the Freer Logion, which we don't think is original, but was added. However, in this case, it's one of the earliest witnesses to the traditional, it is the earliest extant witness to the reading Asa, the traditional reading. Again, looking at the apparatus, you'll find it's also in Codices Gamma, Delta. It's in minuscules 33, 565, 579, 892, 1241, 1424. And the apparatus reveals to us that it is in the majority. is in the majority of extant manuscripts. So there are probably well over 1,000 manuscripts that read Asa. So it was the consensus reading of the Greek New Testament. Then with respect to the versional evidence, the translations, it was in the Latin Vulgate of Jerome and also in the Syriac tradition. And it just lists the Syriac. As we're going to see, there's one slight variation with the Heraclean Syriac where there are some marginal readings that read Asaph. But by and large, the Syriac tradition, whether that's the Old Syriac, the Curetonian Syriac, the Sinaitic Syriac, or the Vulgar Syriac, the Peshitta, the reading is Asa. So it has early attestation, W. It's the dominant reading. It's in versional witnesses, dominant popular versional witnesses like the Syriac Peshitta, like the Latin Vulgate of Jerome. What about on the other side? What about the modern critical text? Why would this be preferred by those who hold to the modern critical text? In support of it, there is one papyrus that is a witness to the reading Asaph. And that reading is found in Papyrus 1. I think this was the one that Erasmus had access to, but he did not choose this reading. He chose Asa rather than Asaph. But in the apparatus, it notes this Papyrus 1, but it puts in parentheses V-I-D, which means it appears. So that's what they think it reads, but it's not totally clear. It's also in Codex Aleph, which is Codex Sinaiticus. It's in Codex B or Vaticanus, which means it's in the two early heavyweight unseals of the fourth century, dated to the fourth century. It's also in Codex C, a Frami Rescriptus. It's in Family 1, Family 13, and in Minuscule 700. And then, with respect to versional witnesses, it's also found in the Old Latin manuscripts, those various disparate Latin manuscripts that eventually were replaced by the Vulgate. And it is also found in, as I already mentioned, some marginal readings in the Heraclean Syriac. And it's also the reading that's found in the Coptic, Asaph. And so what should the reading be? Should it be Asa or Asaph? So we've looked at the external evidence, let's turn to the internal evidence. We might just begin by noting that obviously, if you were to go back and look at 1 Kings, you would see that the son of Abijam, or Abiah, as his name is listed in the Matthean genealogy, and there's no dispute about that, no variation on that. But his son, if you look in the Old Testament, whether you were to look in the Hebrew Masoretic text or you look in the Greek translations of it, the Septuagint or various other Old Greek translations of the Old Testament, the name that would appear there would be Asa. So in the Septuagint, it would be Alpha Sigma Alpha, Asa. So that's the reading. What about Asaph? Well, there's no evidence that Asaph was a variant reading for the name Asa. The most well-known person in the Old Testament with the name Asaph was one of the persons to whom some of the Psalms are attributed, the Psalms of Asaph. And so why would the reading Asaph appear in some early manuscripts like Sinaiticus and Vaticanus rather than Asa? Well, the view of the modern critical text is it appears there because it is the earliest. And it was only later pious scribes who came along and said, hey, the reading here is Asaph, but that's really wrong, or people could get confused and think this was Asaph the psalmist, and we're going to correct it back to Asa, which would be more in fitting with the Old Testament. Again, whether that's the Masoretic text of the Hebrew Old Testament or the Greek translations of it. So that's going to be the basic rationale. Now, we're going to turn from the external evidence and talk a little bit more about the internal evidence. And the place I want to begin is with the textual commentary on the New Testament, the Greek New Testament, from Bruce M. Metzger. And so this is always a go-to source if you want to get a sense for what the modern critical text scholars were thinking in their formulation of their text. And so Metzger has a section in his textual commentary on the Greek New Testament on Matthew 1, verses 7 and 8. In fact, it's the very first entry in the entire commentary. And he suggests that the reading, and he's reflecting the committee that came up with the Nestle-Aland Greek text, NA27, NA26, NA27, and that reading is adopted in NA28, although Metzger had passed away and was a part of the editorial team for that. But anyways, he suggests the reading Asaph, both in verse 7 and in verse 8, and the committee gives this a B rating. They rate these variants, and if it's an A, it means they feel very strongly that their reading is correct. They only give this reading, however, a B. What is their argument? And Metzger starts off by noting that in the opinion of the committee, Asaph is what he calls the earliest form of text preserved in the manuscripts. And he also notes that it comes from a diverse geographical background, that it's found in traditions in various places, and in various so-called text types. Some of this language has become outdated with the rise of new methodology, but this is the language that's being used when Metzger was editing this textual commentary. So let me just read the opening. There is just two paragraphs, the entry on Matthew 1, 7, 8, page 17. He starts off, "It is clear that the name Asaph is the earliest form of text preserved in the manuscripts. For the agreement of Alexandrian," and he notes Sinaiticus and Vaticanus, "and other witnesses, family 1, family 13, 700 and 1071, with Eastern versions, the Coptic, the Armenian, the Ethiopic, and the Georgian, and representatives of the Western texts, the Old Latin manuscripts, and D, Codex Beza, in Luke." And this is interesting to sort of force his point. He says that if you look at Codex Beza, although it doesn't have the Asaph reading here in Matthew, it does have it in the Lucan genealogy. Rather than Asa, it reads Asaph. He says D is lacking for this part of Matthew. So actually, Beza is not a witness for Matthew, but he's assuming because Asaph is the reading in Luke's genealogy in Luke 3, that this would have been the reading of Beza in Matthew 1. Again, it's a speculation. He may be right, maybe not. We don't know. We don't have the Beza extant in order to examine it. So anyways, he says that this makes a strong combination. He goes on to add the following. He says, "Furthermore, the tendency of scribes observing that the name of the psalmist, Asaph," compare the titles of Psalms 50 and 73 through 83, "was confused with that of Asa, the king of Judah." See 1 Kings chapter 15, verses 9 and following. They would have to correct, their tendency would have been to correct the error, thus accounting for the prevalence of Asa in the later ecclesiastical text and its inclusion in the Textus Receptus. So here's the theory that Metzger is putting forward. He's putting forward that the original reading was Asaph because it's in the earliest manuscripts and it appears in some various textual traditions, Alexandrian, in the Eastern versions, and in the Western traditions, so-called in the Old Latin, and possibly in Codex D, Beza. So that was the original, but because it the scribes recognized that it could be confused with Asaph the psalmist, they corrected it, they harmonized it, and instead of what he thinks is the original reading, Asaph, they changed it to the more historically accurate reading, which would be Asa, as it is found in the traditional text. And so this became the majority text reading. And then this was embraced in the printed editions, the Greek New Testament of the Reformation era. And then it became part of the Protestant translations from that era as well. So that's his assumption. Now, let's see what else Metzger has to say, because I do think it gets kind of interesting to follow the rest of his argument. And this is the second paragraph now in his textual commentary. And now he's going to sort of give you, okay, what's the counter argument for traditionalists who would say that Asa is original? He's going to cite a scholar named Lagrange. So he continues to write, and he says, although most scholars are impressed by the overwhelming weight of textual evidence supporting Asaph, Lagrange demurs, and in his commentary prints Asa as the text of Matthew. He declares on page 5 that literary criticism is not able to admit that the author, who could not have drawn up this list without consulting the Old Testament, would have taken the name of a psalmist in place of a king of Judah. It is necessary, therefore, to suppose that Asaph is a very ancient scribal error, end quote. So Metzger does, he doesn't always do this, but at least in this point, he provides a counterbalance of what would be conservative or traditional response to this be by citing the scholar Lagrange. And he says that Lagrange countered and said, wait a second, the original author of the Gospel of Matthew, of course, as a traditionalist, I would say that was Matthew the Apostle, Matthew the tax collector, Matthew 9:9, that he would have certainly known his Old Testament history. And in formulating and writing the genealogy of the Lord Jesus Christ, he would have consulted the Old Testament and would have known that the proper name to list here would be Asa and not Asaph. And so he says that Asaph is actually an early scribal error. So it was an early scribal error that was picked up in some of these unseals, then picked up in some of these versions. And then later, as the tradition progressed, this error was identified and it was corrected to go back to the original reading, which was Asa, and of course the reading that is historically accurate and historically reliable. So although Metzger is willing to cite this traditional counterpoint, the final statement in the commentary is once again for him to defend the reading of Asaph. And so this is the very last sentence in Metzger's commentary entry on Matthew 1, verses 7 and 8. He says, since, however, the evangelist may have derived material for the genealogy not from the Old Testament directly, but from subsequent genealogical lists in which the erroneous spelling occurred, the committee saw no reason to adopt what appears to be a scribal emendation in the text of Matthew. So let's see if we can get a little better grasp on Metzger's theory or his argument. His theory is that the original author of the Gospel of Matthew, now whether or not he believes in traditional authorship, I don't know. It's unlikely that people in the committee did. That's why he can simply refer to the author as the evangelist, whoever he was. Probably most people influenced by modern historical critical method would say that the author was just some anonymous Christian of the first century. So anyways, he says that he wasn't dependent for his genealogy on the Old Testament. Instead, he was dependent upon genealogical lists of the family tree of Jesus. And in these genealogical lists, hypothetical lists that were used by the evangelist, then there was the reading Asaph, the erroneous reading. It should have read Asaph, but it read Asaph. And Matthew, whoever he was, simply incorporated that into his genealogical list. Of course, the problem for a traditionalist is, lots of problems with it. I mean, it assumes so many things. It's hypothetical. It assumes a theory of source criticism that Matthew was not relying on the Old Testament for this genealogy, but he was relying on some extra biblical source that he had access to. And it further assumes that that source had an error in it that the author, Matthew or some anonymous early Christian, wrongly incorporated into the text of Matthew, and that was the original reading. And only later did pious scribes who cared about historical accuracy correct this. And it's really interesting because it does give you a window into understanding, I think, the mindset of most modern text critics who are committed to modern reconstruction. That is, they see the New Testament as a damaged, corrupted document. Even the original had erroneous things within it. And later scribes did not preserve the original, but they tampered with it and they attempted to correct it. This very much sounds like Bart Ehrman, who will come along later and talk about the orthodox corruption of Scripture. So basically, they see the Asa reading as an orthodox corruption. The original reading was Asaph, which was a historical inaccuracy, and the later scribes corrupted it. And now they're coming through and correcting it back to the erroneous original, if that makes sense. As I was reflecting on trying to get inside Metzger's way of thinking about this, I was reminded of, I just recorded this week an audio version of my book review of David C. Parker's book on text criticism and modern scholarship. And there was a line in there that I kind of had forgotten about within Parker's book, where he said on page 104, "The editor is the person who confronts this terrifying anarchy of competing variants and is, in effect, the scholarly world's exorcist who drives out the legion demons and leaves the work sitting and clothed and in its right mind." So the modern scholar, whether Metzger or Parker, David C. Parker, sees himself as an exorcist. And he sees the traditional text as a demon-possessed monstrosity. And it's the job of the modern critical scientific method using text critic to take this mangled monstrosity and to clean it up and to exorcise the bad readings and to restore the text to its right mind, to continue to use his analogy drawn from Christ's casting out of the demon as recorded in the Gospels. So in this case, however, it appears that what is suggested by Metzger, to use Parker's analogy, would not be an exorcism, but it would sort of be an anti-exorcism, because he sees the original reading, Asaph, is actually a corruption, historical error, and he wants to take out the traditional reading, which is historically accurate, Asa, and replace it with an erroneous corruption. So it's kind of an anti-exorcism. He wants to restore something that is an error. He wants to restore a demon, to use his analogy, into the text. As I was thinking about this, I was just wondering, let's say you're preaching through the genealogy. Probably many pastors will be doing that around this time of the year, close to Christmas, even as I did last Sunday. Maybe just preaching through the Gospel of Matthew as I am. And you get to Matthew 1, verses 7 and 8, and you have a modern translation like the RSV or the NRSV or the ESV in that tradition. And it reads there Asaph rather than Asa. Do you take the time to explain to your congregation that actually King Asa from the Old Testament was in the historical line of Jesus, but Matthew made a mistake and wrote his name not as Asa, but as Asaph? And if by chance you were to do that, what impact do you think that's going to have on the audience? What long-term impact will come upon the audience for that kind of preaching, where the minister is constantly pointing to supposed errors that were there within the original text of the New Testament? My sense is that would contribute not to enriching the admiration of the hearers for the authority and the infallibility and the preservation of Scripture, but it would subtly undermine that. And that's true in this case in Matthew 1, 7, and 8, where there's just one word at stake, the name of this king, Asa. And to suggest that the name should be originally was Asaph, and it seems that it would certainly undermine one's sense of confidence in the historical accuracy and reliability of the New Testament. Now, we've talked about this reading here in Matthew 1, 7, and 8. There's a very similar type of issue in verse 10. And so if you have a Bible translation based on the traditional text, like the Authorized Version, you'll look at verse 10 and it says, "And Ezekias or Hezekiah begat Manasseh or Manasseh, and Manasseh begat Ammon, and Ammon begat Josias." And so the point here would be Ammon, A-M-O-N would be the English rendering of the name Ammon. But if you have a translation based on the modern critical text, rather than Ammon, it reads here Amos. And so it's a similar issue. Ammon is the historically accurate name for the king who was the son of Manasseh and the father of Josiah. But in the modern critical text, if you have the ESV, for example, based on the modern critical text, instead of Ammon, it reads Amos. And this could be very easily confused with the prophet Amos, just as in Matthew 1, 7, and 8. If it reads Asaph, it could be confused with the psalmist Asaph. So it's an issue in Matthew 1, 7, and 8 with Asa versus Asaph. It's an issue in Matthew 1, 10 with Ammon versus Amos. In both cases, I don't see any reason why we should abandon the traditional reading. As I've already pointed out with respect to Matthew 1, verses 7 and 8, the traditional reading is attested in a very early source. It's in Codex W. It is the predominant reading in the extant, vast majority of extant Greek manuscripts. It is the reading that appeared in the most popular versions in the ancient context, in the Latin Vulgate, in the Peshitta. And the same is true for Ammon in chapter 1 and verse 10. And so I don't think there's any compelling reason to abandon the traditional readings. Asa in Matthew 1, 7 and 8, and Ammon in Matthew 1, 10, as some modern translations are doing. In fact, I think there's definitely a downside to abandoning those traditional readings, and that is we introduce a lack of confidence in the historical reliability, infallibility, preservation of Scripture. Well, this brings this Word Magazine to a conclusion. I hope this textual note has been of some help to those who are listening. Again, I will put my notes up for this episode at my blog, jeffriddle.net. You can read some of the particulars of it there. And I hope this has been profitable and will prove edifying for those who are listening. And I'll look forward to speaking to you in the next Word Magazine. Till then, take care and God bless.